Hey everybody, Pastor Scott here. And on behalf of Pastor Sexton and everybody at the Worship Center, we'd like to thank you for viewing. If you're from our viewing area, we'd like to invite you to our service Sunday morning at 10:45. We are located at 420 Cardinal Drive in Bourbonnais, Illinois, and we would love the opportunity to connect with you. If you have Twitter, follow us at My Worship Center, or go to our website, myworshipcenter.net. There you can view the Worship Center replays, see our upcoming events, and learn more about our ministries. Whether you are homesick, working, or watching from a long distance, it's our prayer that you'll be uplifted and encouraged. Thank you, and we hope to see you soon.
I want to preach to you on the subject today of finders, weepers, losers, keepers. Finders, weepers, losers, keepers. We used to play a game called finders, keepers, losers, weepers. Meaning if you lost something and someone else found it, finders, keepers, losers, weepers. But I found in the kingdom of heaven, it's not really what you are able to keep, but it's what you're able to give away. And it's not necessarily what you obtain, or it's not necessarily always being first, but it's about serving. And so, hence the title, Finders, Weepers, Losers, Keepers. I'll begin reading from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 19, beginning in verse 16. I'll be reading from the New King James Version. And it reads, "Now behold, one came and said to him, Good teacher, what good things shall I do that I may have eternal life? So he said to him, Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. He said to him, Which ones? Jesus said, You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And the young man said to him, All these things I've kept from my youth. What do I still lack? And Jesus said to him, If you want to be perfect, go sell what you have, give it to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven, and come, follow me. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Then Jesus said to his disciples, Assuredly I say to you that it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And again I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And when his disciples heard it, they were greatly astonished, saying, Who then can be saved? But Jesus looked at them and said to them, With men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Then Peter answered and said to him, See, we have left all and followed you. Therefore, what shall we have? Let me just pause parenthetically and say, Peter was saying, we've given it all up. What about us? What do we get? What do we get out of the deal? Verse 28, so Jesus said to them, Assuredly I say to you that in the regeneration when the Son of Man sits on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone, who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive a hundredfold and inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. Father, would you add your anointing to the preaching of the word this morning? Give us ears to hear what your spirit is saying, and we'll give you praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn around and shake hands with one or two other people that you haven't greeted. Maybe some other folks have stepped in. And tell them, just give them a big smile and say, hello there. It's good to see you today. Now, as I mentioned, our attendance is down a little bit today, and I'm not saying that to poor mouth or anything. That just means that y'all going to have to shout a little louder and help me a little more. Pastor needs your prayers and all your amens as we preach this morning on the subject, finders, weepers, losers, keepers. What this rich young ruler was trying to get over to Jesus and what Jesus was trying to get over to him was, what will you gain when you lose? That's a paradox. You gain by losing. You rise by falling. You live by dying. You win by losing. Jesus said, if you want to be great, you have to serve. If you want to be first, you have to be last. If you want to gain something in the kingdom of God, you've got to turn some things loose. And this incident is messaged in all of the synoptic gospel accounts. Jesus is making his final entrance into Jerusalem, and each of the recordings of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, those are the synoptic gospel writers, there is a final example of obstinance toward Christ that leads a person, for one reason or another, to turn their back on Jesus and walk away. And in this crowd, it is this rich young ruler. So I want us to take a look at this rich young ruler for a moment. The word of the text suggests that he is one who is in power or one who has come into authority. Perhaps he is a civil magistrate. He perhaps comes from blue blood. Perhaps he is an aristocrat. Perhaps he is used to having it his way. Perhaps he's used to buying whatever he wants. I'd say he's used to calling the shots. He's accustomed to being in charge. He's drawn to Jesus because in each of the gospel accounts, prior to this encounter with the rich young ruler, Jesus is blessing children. And he's saying to the crowd that is following him, except you become like one of these, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Unless you become a helpless, dependent child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Somebody help me while I preach today. Come on, Pastor. And this rich young ruler, he was used to being anything but dependent. He's anything but helpless. But as drawn as he was to Jesus, there was a fatal flaw in his thinking. There was a glitch in his reasoning. Because he's accustomed to getting what he wants. So he thinks that he has to do something. He thinks he has to buy something or earn something, or he has to do something in order to gain life, eternal life. You see, he rules. He is a ruler. The text calls him a rich young ruler. He's a ruler. He is in charge. He is captain of his own soul. He is a master of his own fate. He calls the shots. He controls his own destiny, and he's made choices and life choices that have brought him to the pinnacle of success. He's strong, he's young, he's rich, he's handsome. He has the tiger by the tail. How many of you know what I'm talking about? He got a tiger by the tail. He doesn't need anything but eternal life. And in order to gain it or to acquire it, he thinks he can pay for it or merit it or be good enough to deserve it or smart enough to think it through or attractive enough to smile at it. He thinks he's really ruling. Like some people that are listening to me today, you think that you're really large and in charge of your destiny. You think you're really balling up there where you are right now. You really think you've got the world by the tail. You think that you're in control. You think that you're healthy. You think that you're strong. You've got a car, a pretty nice car, and maybe you got a house, a pretty nice house, and maybe if you're one of the fortunate ones, you've got some retirement or maybe a 401k. You've got a plan A and a plan B. Help me while I preach. You're working it out. You're doing it. Nobody's like you. Nobody can stop you. You're on the pathway to success. You're strong. You're intelligent. You're educated. You're smart. You're good looking. And you're well healed up. You know all of the right people. You've networked in the business community. You're a Delta. You're a Mason. You're a Eastern Star. You've got money. You've got influence. You've got the picket fence, the little white house. You've got the beautiful wife, the perfect children. You've got it all together, and you think that you're really ruling. Oh, help me while I preach today. And like many of us, this rich young ruler is stuck in a spiritual no man's land. He's too religious to enjoy sin and too sinful to enjoy Christ. Help me while I preach. He's got enough Jesus to be informed, but not enough to be transformed. That'll preach right there. I'm just telling you. Brothers and sisters, we mess people up when we make them think that they can follow Jesus on their own terms. God will not accept you on your own terms. I wish I had a witness up in here this morning. God will not accept you on your own terms. You see, we've got to understand. You've got to understand. You don't make the rules when it comes to the kingdom of heaven. You don't call the shots when it comes to the kingdom of God. God is in complete control, and we mislead people when we make people believe that there is something that they can bring to the table when they come to the kingdom of God. We cheapen the gospel by allowing people to think that they can buy into Christianity without selling out. We've made church too convenient. We've made being a Christian too comfortable. The bus leaves from here. I feel like preaching today. I said we've made church too convenient. We've made church too comfortable. We've made being a Christian too comfortable. And so people believe that they can sit in here on Sunday morning and by their very presence suggest that God really needs me. But let me tell you again, sir. Let me tell you again, ma'am, that the very air that you breathe comes from God Almighty. Every step that you take, every thought that comes into your mind, every movement of your arms, every movement of your legs, your eyes to see, your ears to hear, your voice to talk, it all comes from Him. In Him we live, and you are not in control, sir. You are not in control, ma'am. And we don't rule anything. God owns and rules it all. Somebody praise Him in this house.
Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus says to this young man, you know the commandments, keep them. And he says to Jesus, which commandments are you talking about? And Jesus gives him the second half of the Decalogue, the second half of the Ten Commandments, which has to do with man's duty to man, how we treat one another. Don't kill nobody. Didn't say you never felt like it. How many of you are sitting next to... Never mind. Every woman's hand in the building would go up. The men, sometimes we're ignorant. Don't kill nobody. That wasn't anointed. Don't kill nobody. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't lie. Honor your mom and your dad. Love your neighbor like you love yourself. And not to be outdone, this young man said, I've been doing all of that. In fact, I've been doing all that since I was a youth, since I was a kid. So what am I lacking? And Jesus gets right down to where the rubber meets the road, and he says, if you will be perfect, if you will live up to the standard of the law, if you will live up to God's irreducible minimum, go and sell what you have, give to the poor, then come back and resubmit your application. And then I might let you walk with me in the kingdom of heaven. And the Bible says he turned away sorrowfully, for he had great possessions. His heartstrings were tied to his checkbook. This young man could not turn that bling bling loose. He couldn't turn his money loose. And the Lord was deeply moved, and the rich young man was really a poor young man after all. And he went home to all of his plentiful riches to be haunted forever by all that he had just thrown away. He had a full safe, but an empty soul. He had a fat bank account, but he had a skinny spirit. He had large investments, but he was bankrupt in his heart. He, like many people, knew the price of everything, but knew the value of nothing. And he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. I want to move, if I can, transition from this ruler to a sobering reality. Jesus makes this young ruler an object lesson for the disciples. And he says, here it is in the text, "Assuredly I say to you, that a rich man shall hardly enter the kingdom of heaven. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God." And the word sometimes doesn't seem to resonate with us, because when we read this, many people think that Jesus is condemning the rich person. He's not condemning having riches. Abraham was rich. Job was rich. Solomon was rich. God's not against riches. Riches will not keep you out of heaven, and being broke won't get you in to heaven. Here's what Jesus is saying. We do a disservice to the text. We do violence to the text when we lessen the severity of what Jesus is telling us. Some scholars contend that what Jesus was talking about was when the gates of the city were closed, there was a smaller gate called the eye of the needle, and a camel could go through a smaller gate after he bent down below it, but that he still gets in. He can bend down, unload, and then pull his riches in. But there is no linguistic evidence in the Greek New Testament to suggest that there is some smaller door that you can get in besides the big door. So what we have to presume is that Jesus is using hyperbole to illustrate a humorous impossibility. A camel cannot go through an eye of a needle. That is metaphysically impossible. And any man or any woman who trusts in their riches — now, I didn't say riches will keep you out of heaven. I said if you trust in your riches. You know, some people think that a sign of God's favor, that a sign that you're on God's side and a sign that you have God's favor, is if you have a nice car. Well, dope addicts have nice cars.
Amen. Amen. Come on now.
Crack dealers have nice cars.
Come on now.
Whole lot of folks who don't go to church live in nice houses. Go in my neighborhood. Jesus said, just like a camel cannot go through the eye of a needle, anyone who trusts foolishly in riches cannot enter the kingdom of God. Listen to me, church. Thank God for his blessings. In fact, why don't you take about 5 seconds to give him a praise break? Thank him for your blessings. Thank God for blessings. Thank God for houses. Thank God for money. Thank God for nice clothes. And you ought to have all that kind of stuff. Now, there'll be some people tell you that the broker you are, the closer you are to God. Well, I found it easier to praise him when I got a little food in the refrigerator and something to wear and something to drive than whenever I don't. Amen. So listen to me. Thank God for houses, and thank God for money, and thank God for nice clothes. And you ought to have all of that kind of stuff, but you don't impress God with it. You don't impress God with your stocks. You don't move him because you know big people. God's not on knocked off his throne because you've got a bank account. God gave you that bank account, and he wants you to have that bank account, because if he didn't want you to have that bank account, you would not have a bank account. Amen. But he wants you to use it for his glory. Can I have an amen? He wants you to be able to pay your bills, and in order for you to pay your bills, you got to have some money. Somebody say amen. You need to pay your bills. You need to take care of yourself. God wants you to have all the best things that life has to offer, that he blesses you with. God is not against you having stuff. God is not opposed to you driving and wearing and eating good things. God's all for that. But whenever you put that in front of God, whenever you are defined by what you own and what you have, and when you start name dropping and you start to trying to build yourself up by who you know and what you have and what you possess, when you get possessed by your possessions, you, sir, cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. Everything that you have, hold it with a loose grip. Because one day it's going to leave you, and you're going to leave it. Have a nice house. Enjoy yourself in that nice house. Invite Pastor over for chicken dinner in that nice house. Doesn't make God any difference how many square feet your house is. But without God, your frozen steaks are about to thaw. Without God, your wall-to-wall carpet becomes wall-to-wall misery. Because if you trust in that stuff more than you trust in God, you cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. I'll go ahead and praise the Lord in here. You know, brothers and sisters, in the church world, sometimes we get cliquish and clannish of folks who don't look like us, dress like us, smell like us, and got it going on like us. So we associate with those people who do look like us, dress like us, smell like us. We associate with those people. And the poor and the marginalized, the locked out, never get a chance in some churches. Because they don't look like us. I'm telling it. They don't smell like us. They don't dress like us. And because they don't get a chance to sit with us, because us, we have a certain pew that we sit on. And only certain folks can sit on that pew with us. As if us is really somebody. All it takes, folks, is 24 hours. And the folk who are at the top, God can see that you come all the way to the bottom.
Amen. Amen.
All that money you've stockpiled, all it takes is a stretch of sickness. And every dime that you have can be that you've accumulated can go to doctors and hospitals. Have I got a witness here from anybody today? I mean, you wear nice clothes, you look good in them. But all it takes is a moment, and that stuff could be burned up in a fire just like that. That's why the scripture says, don't lay up treasures where moth can corrupt and where thieves can break through and steal it, but lay up treasures in heaven where the moth cannot corrupt it and thieves cannot break through and steal it. And seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. I got a witness from anybody.
Amen.
Help me testify in here today, will you? See, I want you to know I was praising God before I had any nice stuff. I was praising God when I had a car that the... You remember Glenn in Lexington, we had that car. We had that blue car. Thought it was a good car. And it was a real good car until it threw a rod in the motor. But you know what? I was praising God when that rod got through that motor. I was praising God when I had a clunker before I had a nice car. I was praising God before I had a nice suit. I was clapping my hands and enjoying myself and shouting myself in church before I ever bought a house. God's been good to me. And so I'm not going to be so crazy about the gift that I don't give glory to the giver of the gift. Because everything that I have has come from the Lord. And let me give you a little side note here. If God takes all of that stuff tonight, I'll be back here next Sunday morning in blue jeans and a t-shirt from the Goodwill store saying, "Hallelujah, thank you, God, for saving me." Do I got a witness from anybody? Who am I preaching to here today? I want us to finally look this morning at the reward, because when you read the text, that young man walked away sorrowfully. The disciples and Jesus were poor. Now, I know, well, Jesus owned cattle, I get that, and depending on which side of the theological fence that you happen to fall in, whatever pasture, I guess, but really, when it says foxes have holes, but the Son of Man doesn't even have a place to lay his head, that lets me know that at least while here on earth, Jesus was a homeless person. Yeah, some of y'all have to chew on that one for a minute. The disciples were poor. Jesus was poor. Look at this. Here's this rich young ruler. He's got influence. He's got money. He's got it all. And they could have used, that ministry could have used a large infusion of cash. This man could have been profitable for the ministry. He had money. He knew some people. He could have got some permits pulled downtown. He knew some people. He had money. He had influence. He really could have been of some good use to this little ragtag motley crew called the disciples. But Jesus will not use anybody who puts riches before God.
Amen.
And when this rich young man walked away and Jesus told them about the eye of the needle, the camel going through the eye of the needle, and one of the disciples said, "Well, then who can be saved? If a rich man can't get in, if a poor man can't get in, then who can be saved?" And the whole point of the message is, with men, it's impossible. If you're rich, it's impossible to get into heaven without Jesus. If you're poor, it's impossible to get into heaven without Jesus. If you're good, it's impossible to get into heaven without Jesus. If you're bad, and yay, if you are very bad, it is impossible to get into heaven without Jesus. If you can sing, it's impossible to get into heaven without Jesus. If you can preach the paint off the wall, it's impossible for you to get into heaven without Jesus. If you go to church every Sunday, it's impossible for you to get into heaven without Jesus. With men, it is impossible. But with God, even if I don't have any money, I've still got God. And even if nobody likes me at this church, I've still got God. And even if you won't let me sit on your old pew, if I've got God, if I never get a chance to sing a song, if I never get a chance to lead in worship, if I never get a chance to sing a special or receive the offering, if I've got God, then I've got everything I need to sustain me. Help me while I preach. Will you help me close? Will you help me close? When we get to heaven, there's going to be some shock in store for us. We're going to be shocked at some people we thought were going to be there, and they're not there.
Come on now. Come on now. Come on now.
And then we're going to be shocked by some people that we thought would not get there that are there. And then I got news for you. We're going to be shocked to find out that we even made it. Amen. Can I have a witness from somebody? Because when I think of how low down I am, and when I think about what a liar I am, and when I think about all the mistakes that I've made in the past, and when I think about how God really should have killed me a long time ago, and when I think about how mean I've been, and how ornery I have been, and how unfaithful I have been to God at times, but yet God still stands me up here every Sunday morning and lets me preach His gospel. He still lets me breathe His air. He still makes my heart beat. He still allows me to come into His presence. God, I'm amazed that You would save somebody like me. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Somebody help me now. Has saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. I thank God that He saved me. I thank God that He saved me because there was nothing in me to merit salvation.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Nothing in me to merit salvation. I'm trying to quit. Peter said, Lord, we've left everything to follow You. We've thrown our nets overboard. We've left our families. We've left our lucrative businesses. We've left our thriving lifestyle. We've chunked it all away to follow after You. What's in it for us? See, some of you thought you were the only people that ever asked God that. Peter asked Him that. We read it in the text this morning. What's in it for us? As I hurry toward the close, let me tell you what's in it for you. In AD 44... King Herod ordered that James, the brother of Jesus, be killed with a sword. You want to know what's in it for you? Luke was hung from an olive tree in Greece. Oh, you want to know what's in it for you? Thomas was pierced with a pine spear, tortured, and burned alive in India. Oh, I want to know what's in it for me. Let me tell you what's in it for you. In AD 54, Philip was tortured and crucified, but he kept on preaching while he was on the cross. What's in it for me? Matthew was stabbed in the back while preaching in Ethiopia. Bartholomew was flogged to death. Preacher, what's in it for me? What's in it for me? James, the just, was thrown 100 feet from the southwest pinnacle of the temple. Guts splattered all over the ground. What's in it for me? Simon the Zealot was crucified. Thaddeus was beaten to death in Mesopotamia. Matthias, who replaced Judas, was stoned and beheaded. What's in it for me? What's in it for me? Peter was crucified upside down at his own request because he did not count himself worthy to be crucified upright like Jesus was. What's in it for me, preacher? John, the beloved disciple, was the only disciple who died of natural causes, but that's because he survived being boiled in oil and died on the Isle of Patmos at 95 years old. Do you want to know what's in it for you? Let me tell you. Andrew was crucified in the form of an X, which now gives us what we call the cross of Andrew. You want to know what's in it for you for serving God? You want to know what's in it for you for living a Christian lifestyle? Do you want to know what's in it for you for selling totally out to God? I'm going to tell you, there's pain in it for you. There's suffering in it for you. People who will lie on you, that's what's in it for you. Folk who you love who will walk out on you. What's in it for me? I'll tell you, people will talk bad about you. People you've tried to be good to will lie on you behind your back. Your children will break your heart. Your loved ones will criticize you. People at the church will misunderstand you. That's what's in it for you. You're going to have to cry sometimes, and your heart's going to be broken sometimes. But let me tell you what else is in it for you. Weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Let me tell you what else is in it for you. Peace that will pass all understanding. Do you want to know what else is in it for you? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Let me tell you what else is in it for you. There's joy. There's shouting. There's rejoicing. There's happiness. There's blessing. Because when you follow Jesus, he's obligated himself to do some things for you. And I wouldn't trade this life for anything else in the world. Oh, somebody praise him in this house.
Thank you, Lord.
Every one of the 12 names that I just got through mentioning in the text, Jesus said, when I come into my kingdom, every last one of you is going to sit on a throne. They crucified you, but you're going to sit on a throne. They boiled you in oil. But John, you're going to sit on a throne. They flogged you to death, but I got a throne for you. They got a kingdom, but you got a throne. Let me tell you what else that you will gain when you lose. You'll gain eternal life. You'll gain a joy that is unspeakable and full of glory. You will gain. Hear, Pastor, today, you will gain. There will be some people who will walk out of your life. Oh, somebody tell me to go ahead and preach. There will be some people who will walk out of your life, but truth be told, they should have never been in your life to begin with. Somebody shout with me in here. They don't mean you no good. They don't want to see you prosper. They don't like it when the Lord blesses you. So don't let that low down, sorry, low down, no good person, don't get mad if they walk out of your life, because God's got 10 more people who'll come back and bless you in ways that you never thought was imaginable. Somebody help me. Who am I preaching to right now? When the Lord blesses your life, when the Lord gives you things that you never thought you would have, you ought to come to church and thank him for what you lost.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
I said you ought to come to church and thank him for some things that you lost and some people that you lost. And quit you crying and bellyaching about what you ain't got and learn how to praise God for what you do got. He'll give you joy in the midnight hour. He'll wipe tears away from your eyes. He'll heal your sick body. He'll make a way out of no way. Is there anybody in here today who's glad that they decided to follow Jesus? Because when you follow him, you can't lose. I'm trying to quit. Thank you, sis. I will. Appreciate it. You got to be over 40 to help me testify right here. I want to get to my sermon title. I preached all this to get to my sermon title. Because usually what I do, I work backwards. I'll study and get things out, and then I'll try to come up with a title. Sometimes that works, sometimes eh. When we were children, we'd be out walking along or sitting down with friends, and somebody'd lose a dollar. Or lose a quarter, or lose a toy. And only the over 40 crowd can help me testify here. Only the over 40 crowd can help me shout right here. Come on now. Come on now. Something fall out of their pocket, some money. We'd pick it up and we'd say, finders, keepers, losers, weepers. Can I get a witness from anybody over 40? Finders. That's mine. Finders keepers. Losers weepers. Sorry. That's the way it happens in the world. But when you come to Jesus, it's all a different way. It's no longer finders, keepers, losers, weepers. It becomes finders, weepers, losers, keepers. Because the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. And if the Lord opened a door for you, you can't lose, and nobody can close it. And if the Lord made a way for you out of no way, you can't lose. It's time to give Him some praise in here today. Can you do that? Since the Lord has been opening doors for you, and since the Lord has been rolling back stones for you, and since the Lord has been making a way out of no way for you, since the Lord made your enemies leave you alone, why don't you just clap your hands unto Him one big time? And why don't you stand all across this building? And why don't you shake somebody's hands? Look over at your neighbor, shake somebody's hand, and say, finders, weepers, losers, keepers. Why is that so important, Pastor? Because when I lose this, when I lost this, God gave me that. And whenever I lose that, God will give me this. He'll restore. I truthfully believe this. He will restore what the devil stole from you. Somebody shake. Somebody shout in here. He'll restore what the devil stole. He'll give you back the joy of your salvation. Is there anybody in here that knows that you can get it back? Amen. 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 See, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. Sinking sand. Right now, you ought to tell the devil, devil, you can't have my son. Devil, you can't have my daughter. You can't have my money. You can't have my health. I belong to God. Would you tell him that right now? Would you tell him that? Would you tell him that? Would you tell him that? Tell him that, devil, you can't have it. You can't have it. You can't have it. You can't have it. I want us to skip to the second song. Skip to the second song. I want you to come down. This is a little different. I want you to head down to this altar right now. And I want us to give Him about 6 or 7 minutes of just praise right now. Would you do that? Let's lift our voices unto the Lord. Come on down. Come on down. And remember, finders, weepers, losers, keepers. But it's really finders, weepers, losers, keepers. Can you give Him some praise? Hallelujah. Come on now. Praise the Lord.
Sing hallelujah. To our God. Glory, hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah.
It's to our God.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Come on, put your hands together.
Y'all got it now. Help us sing it.
Every praise.
It's to our God.
I want you to look to your neighbor and say, I'm glad that He saved me. I'm glad that He saved me. Tell him I wouldn't trade being saved for anything in the world. Wouldn't trade it for anything in the world.
Sing
praise.
It's to our God.
It's to our God.
Every word of worship.
Every word of worship.
With one accord.
With one accord.
Come on, say every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.
It's to our God.
It's to our God.
Worship the Lord.
The world.